Grace and peace to you, church. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, welcome to worship on this Palm Sunday. Welcome, church. Welcome, choir. Thank you, thank you, thank you for coming together, answering God's call, God's invitation to all and each of you to come together and worship as a church, both here in the room, online. It is good to gather in God's house on this Palm Sunday. Your bulletin is full of all kinds of things. I want to, first thing, you'll see an envelope in there. That is for the One Great Hour of Sharing. That's a special offering through the denomination that's taken up during Lent and Easter. You're invited to read about that in your bulletin and listen if God is guiding you to give. That goes toward the Presbyterian Hunger Program, disaster assistance, and self-development of all people around the world. It's a wonderful offering to give to, so give freely when the time comes. You're welcome to give to that special offering, as well as the Amity offering. But that is just one of the wonderful things happening. There's also a note in the announcements in the back of your bulletin. Well, I guess it's kind of in the inside of your bulletin. I'm going to jump ahead to after Easter. On April 2nd, you all know that we have our community garden in the back field of the church. And the Mecklenburg County Edible Landscape Program is who helped us get that started. And they have decided to give us two more raised beds. They're going to help us install those, provide all the stuff for it on April 2nd. So that is a Tuesday morning after Easter. We're hoping to get as many folks out to help with that. There will also be, a special program from the North Carolina Master Gardeners, North Carolina State Master Gardeners group. They're going to offer a program on vermiculture. If you don't know what that is, worms. It's all about worms and how good they are for your garden and what they do to the soil and how you can use them in your garden at home and how we can here. Plus, it's cool. It's about worms. So if you know any kids that would like to come to that, that's during spring break. I mean, when you say, come learn about worms, how could you turn that down? So invite your neighbors, friends, relatives, and come on out for this next phase in our community garden that is already growing beautiful, beautiful fruit. Today is Palm Sunday, which means it is the start of Holy Week. You'll see on the back of your bulletin the ways that we as a church are moving together through Holy Week. The first thing to note is that on Friday, we are having a Good Friday worship service here in the sanctuary at 6:30 in the evening. It will be a little bit different. We're going to begin with communion, kind of bring in Maundy Thursday. Begin with communion, a celebration of the Lord's Supper, and then together we will shift, we will turn toward the cross in worship, where we remember the death of Christ through the telling of Scripture. And that is going to be a tenebrae service, which is a word that means darkness. It's a service of darkness. So as we move through the story, the lights will come down and we will remember the darkness that seemed to triumph on Good Friday. But we know we will await Easter Sunday. And so speaking of Easter Sunday, next Sunday we will worship here at 11 o'clock together as a whole church with our African Fellowship siblings here at 11. There's going to be all kinds of wonderful things that day. We will have our Easter cross here in worship, and you are invited to flower the cross. You can bring flowers from home, from if you've got any in your yard or garden, to trim those and bring them to add to the cross. We'll also have some flowers here for those who would prefer that. So that's a beautiful part of worship. So come ready to join in. And then, right after worship, we've done it the last couple years. We are going to have our Easter egg hunt for elementary school kids and down. There's a few older youth. Well, they're going to help hide the eggs, so hopefully they won't join in, but they might. You can look for an egg if you want, if you need a piece of chocolate. But that'll be right after church. So kids, bring a basket or a bag or anything you'd like to collect eggs, and we'll go outside. Hopefully it'll be pretty. And we will go outside, and I hope everyone will stay and watch. It's just joy. It's just fun. Invite folks. It's a great thing to invite people to worship and then to go out and have chocolate and candy. Doesn't get much better than that. So I think that's everything. That's a lot. It's all good, church. This is a holy week, truly. We walk through the darkness and into the light, and we will do it together. So as we turn and begin this Holy Week journey, let's begin our Palm Sunday service with prayer.
Let us pray. Holy and loving God, this is the day that you have made. You have filled it with signs of your presence. Your Spirit's breath permeates every moment. Your grace fills each experience. Your promises move through our lives, pulling us toward hope. Receive our thanks, receive our praise through Christ our Lord. For in his love, we know your deep love, your faithfulness, your grace. Amen.
Amen. Church, let's rise. Call one another to worship with the words in your bulletin. We raise our voices and wave with joyful hope the palms of deliverance of God's people.
Hosanna! Hosanna to the Son of David!
Our hearts are filled with expectation as we welcome the coming King.
Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
We receive into the crowded streets of our lives the one who is Savior, not only of us, but of all the earth.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest heaven.
Church, lift your voices and sing to God hymn 197, Hosanna, loud Hosanna. Beloveds, as we begin our journey to the holiest of weeks, let us enter speaking the truth, of our lives and our hearts, as we confess to God and trust in God's goodness, God's love, and God's grace. Let us pray our prayer of confession, first in song, then in the words of your bulletin, and then in silence. Let us pray.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true.
Together we make our confession. Lord, as our Lenten journey draws to a close, we confess that so much of our lives are still rooted in the ways of the world. We are quick to be seduced by power, clamoring for an earthly king who can elevate us to a position of privilege and status over others. Forgive us for not understanding the meaning of your arrival. Give us the courage to continue walking with you, boldly shouting, Hosanna,
save us,
even as the path leads us to the cross. For in it, sharing your suffering and death, that we will be raised with you in glory at Easter. We give you our hearts. Amen. Beloveds, laying aside judgment, God offers us redemption. Setting aside anger, God embraces us with love. Letting go of grief, God pours living water upon us. The truth is that God's steadfast love endures forever. Hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. My friends, let's sing Jesus Loves Me. As children that are here that would like to, come on down to the front.
Jesus loves me.
Always. Do you remember what today is called? What special day in the church it is? Yeah? Is that what you were going to get? That's what you were going to guess, isn't it? Palm Sunday? No? That's okay. I love all kinds of guesses. You're right. Today is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday. What are palms? tree, yeah. And what's the other thing a palm could be?
A flower.
Oh, like a flower, yep. Or your hand, yeah. Or a palm tree, right. Palm branches. Do you see some palm branches around here?
Yes, a bunch.
A bunch, right. Yeah, there's a bunch. That comes from part of our story in the Bible where Jesus entered Jerusalem in a very special way. Now, Jerusalem is a big city. It was a big, holy city where lots of Jews would go to worship. And that's why they were all going to Jerusalem, and Jesus entered in a special, special way. Okay? He could have just walked in, right? Like everybody else. But the Bible says that Jesus asked his disciples to go and get a donkey. Have you ever ridden a donkey?
Nope.
You've ridden a horse? Yeah. Wow, I've never ridden a horse. Donkeys, you know what donkeys look like?
Yes.
Yeah.
They look like a small version of a horse.
They're like a small version of a horse, kind of, but they're really, I got to see donkeys on a trip I was just on. These two donkeys, their names are Minnie Pearl and Maybelle. Those are those donkeys right there. I took that picture. And donkeys, they're like horses, kind of. They're related, but they're shorter, smaller, and wider. Their backs are really wide and really flat. They're good. They carry things. They're often used to carry things from one place to another, or used in farming and growing things, because they're very strong and sturdy. Yes?
They're almost like a camel, but small.
Like a camel, but it's not much smaller than a camel. Do you know how big camels are?
Yes.
They're humongous.
They're like about.
Yes. They're really big.
Yeah.
They're really big. Yep, donkeys are much smaller. And so Jesus, but people didn't often, well, I'll say this. People rode donkeys. But people thought Jesus was coming to be the king. So do you think they would expect him to come into the city riding on a horse or a donkey?
No.
You think on a donkey?
A horse.
Yeah, he did ride on a donkey. But important people rode on horses, not on donkeys. Or they rode in chariots pulled by big, strong, fancy horses, right? But Jesus said, I'm going to ride a donkey. And he did that. We're going to talk a little bit about why when we hear the scripture and we talk in the sermon. I want you to listen. But the people gathered palm branches, and they waved them as he was entering the city, and they said, Hosanna! Or Hosanna! Sorry, Lynn, I'm Southern. Hosanna! And they would, do you know what that means?
Hello?
Doesn't mean hello.
Oh,
good guess, though.
It means praise.
It means praise. Good guess. A lot of people think it means praise.
Save us.
Yes, it means save us. So when they were saying, Hosanna, 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 blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, they were saying, God sent Jesus, this person, to us. He's coming from the Lord, and he is going to save us. They didn't know how, but they believed that he would. They thought that he was going to save them. And so he enters that way, but that's not the end of the story. This week is Holy Week, okay? Next Sunday, what's next Sunday? Do you know? It's a big deal.
Next Sunday is Easter.
Easter, right. Easter is the day that we celebrate in the church. It's a big day. It's a joyful day, okay? But before we get to Easter, we tell the story of how Jesus went into the city. And Jesus wanted to change things, and he wanted to help the people who were often left out, and he wanted to care for people, and he did a lot of things that made the people in power kind of mad, because they weren't always the best, nicest people, right? So he got in trouble, but it was good trouble, okay? But unfortunately, our story of Jesus' life, he goes into the city, and he gets arrested. There's some sad and some scary things that we tell the story of in this week. He gets arrested and he gets killed. And it's a sad, scary part of the story. But we don't stop with that part of the story. Because on Easter, we celebrate that Jesus is what?
Birthday.
Not birthday, that's Christmas. Jesus is alive. He comes back from the dead. He conquers death. He's alive. We say, he is risen. He is risen indeed. That's what we celebrate on Easter. That's a wonderful part of the story. It's an amazing part of the story. But there's some tough parts between now and then. And you know what that means? That even when you have tough parts of your story, even when sad or scary things happen to you, you can trust that it is not the end of your story. Okay? That God is always with you, and good news and joy will come. Okay? But today, I want you to listen as we read the scripture for Palm Sunday, and listen to the story of Jesus riding into the big city, the big holy city, on the back of a little donkey. Sometimes Jesus did some silly things, but he did them for a reason. Sometimes God uses silliness in powerful ways, okay? So be silly too, all right? Okay, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for Jesus. Help us to remember what Jesus would do so that we can know what we should do. Thank you for loving us. Help us to love others. Amen. All right. There's some palm branch coloring sheets on the back in the playground. If you want to color your own, and you can cut them out too. And you can wave your own palm branches, okay? Or you can use these. I don't know. Let's talk after.
first scripture reading comes from Psalm 118, verses 1 through 2 and 19 through 29. Listen for God's word to us today. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Open for me the gates of righteousness, and I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With boughs in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever.
We turn to the Gospel of Mark for our Palm Sunday telling. Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. Listen again for God's word to us today. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. And as they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying that colt?" And they answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and they threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches that they had cut in the fields. And those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything. But since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the word of God, and it is for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's rise and sing glory. Know if you are at all interested in how Jesus' vision for the world can look in our contemporary global culture. His name is Shane Claiborne, and he's the author of several books. He's a theologian, a faith community leader, I'd say one of the more prophetic voices of Generation X. And I read his book called The Irresistible Revolution when I was in seminary about 15 years ago. And this book, it lit a fire in me for how the way of Jesus could change the world that 25 years of growing up immersed in church hadn't been able to do. A book changed my faith. In that book, he tells this story of how in 2002, the folks in this Christian community that he lived in and was cultivating in Philadelphia, they were upset by the increasing wealth inequality in our country. They saw the fact that the rich were getting richer and the poor were getting poorer, something that's only increased in the last two decades since. But they saw that as this direct contradiction to God's dream for creation. And he says that they were inspired by the ancient vision of Jubilee found in the Bible, where God invites the Hebrew people to dismantle economic inequality by doing things like forgiving debt, setting slaves free, redistributing property, land. It was God's emancipation proclamation. It was the Almighty's creative way of systemically interrupting the growing gap between the haves and the have-nots. So Shane Claiborne and this group of Christians, they threw a Jubilee party on Wall Street. He says in his book that they were ready to confront the raging bull head on, ready to flip the tables on the front steps of capitalism's temple. And what they did was they invited the homeless folks in New York, of which there are many, to come to the front entrance of the New York Stock Exchange, where they planned to give away $10,000 in cash. And this $10,000 was money they had that had been tied up in stocks, but that had been de-invested, had been set free, if you use their language. And people came, lots of them. And just as the opening bell rang inside the New York Stock Exchange, Jubilee started rumbling outside. Small bills, dollar bills, were dropped from the balcony of nearby buildings. Dollars raining down on the crowd. A swarm of bicyclists rode through and dumped thousands of quarters. Thousands of quarters on the steps and on the street. Undercover bystanders had come prepared, and they emptied bags and backpacks and purses full of change. And the party was so irresistible that some of the folks in the stock exchange came out to catch a glimpse of the action. One of them even bought a bunch of bagels and started handing them out to whoever was around. They sang and they spoke and they preached of God's dream for a just world. Shane says it wasn't about coins. It was about change. They threw the party there deliberately, to bring the poor and the rich face to face, to expose the economic patterns of Wall Street, of our society that are increasingly leaving masses of people in poverty, with a handful of folks getting wealthier and wealthier. It was brilliant street theater. It was an economic flash mob. It was a little act of divine mischief. He says something deeper and even holy happened that day. It didn't change the world by any means, but it did raise the question about whether the world needed to be changed. I love this story. This, my friends, this is a Palm Sunday story. There were no palm branches, but there were all sorts of palms. There were empty hands of the poor grasping for enough to meet their very basic needs, and there were the busy hands of the Wall Street traders inside. There were no shouts of Hosanna, but Hosanna means save us. And the cries of the poor were heard that day. There was no Savior entering on a donkey, but the people were worshiping. Who or what were they worshiping? Would those inside the doors of the New York Stock Exchange answer that question differently than the ones scrambling for change out on the steps? This Palm Sunday story, it stopped on the steps of what they call, what Shane called our national temple. But Jesus entered his temple. And if we had kept reading in our gospel today, we would see Jesus literally flipping tables of the ones there making money off of the poor and the vulnerable. Church, like this Wall Street Jubilee story, Palm Sunday looks like a joyful Jubilee on the surface, and there is joy, there is worship, there is praise, there is hope. But the subtext of the Palm Sunday story, the subtext is far more powerful and subversive. We do it a disservice if we stop with the joy and the praise. Because this is troublemaker Jesus at his best. This is a protest parade. It's a protest against those in power. It's a parade to prepare the way for a different kind of king. It's a courageous act of political theater. It's designed to draw the attention of any who have eyes to see. To grasp the significance of what Jesus is doing in this scripture, you need to know that across town on the other side of Jerusalem, another drama is unfolding. You see, every year, the Roman governor of Judea rides up to Jerusalem from his coastal residence in the west, specifically to be present in the city for the festival of the Passover. This is the Jewish festival that would swell the population of Jerusalem from its usual 50,000 to about 200,000. The governor would come in all his imperial majesty to remind the Jewish pilgrims that Rome is in charge. Marcus Borg is a biblical scholar. He describes the imperial procession this way. He says, a visual panoply, big words, of imperial power. Cavalry on horses, foot soldiers, leather armor, helmets, weapons, banners, golden eagles mounted on poles, sun glinting on metal and gold, the sounds of the marching of feet, the creaking of leather, the clinking of bridles, the beating of drums, the dust would be swirling. That parade. This parade is an intentional display of power to remind the masses to think very carefully before making any trouble. And according to Roman imperial belief, church, the emperor who the governor represented is not simply the ruler of Rome. He is the Son of God. The Son of God. So for Jews living under the Roman Empire, this would be a display of power, of military threat, and of rival theology. All this drama, all this pomp and circumstance, it is happening at the western gate of Jerusalem, and Jesus knows. Everyone knows. It happens every year, this disturbing reminder of how the world is, of who is in charge and who must obey, and a reminder of the life and death consequences of their disobedience. It was real, a very real threat. And Jesus knows all of this. He's preparing to enter the city of Jerusalem this final time. He knows that he will not leave the city again unscathed. He doesn't leave the city again alive. But as he enters, he prepares to enter, he's accompanied by crowds of people. Most of them would be classified as poor, disenfranchised. They'd be the oddballs and the outcasts. We can assume that his growing reputation precedes him. So others would begin to gather at the gate, right? Some hopeful, ready to follow the one who might save them from their oppressors. Others just curious, looky-loos, what's going on here? Curious about the spectacle. And then, of course, there's the powerful ones. The ones there to gauge the threat this Jesus poses to their safe place in the status quo. The powerful ones from within Jesus' community and the government around them. And Jesus knows all of this. He knows. And knowing all of this, how does he choose to make his entrance into Jerusalem? On the back of a young, untrained donkey. Jesus' feet, he's a grown man. His feet would be dragging the ground on either side. His robe would be getting dirty as this little colt plodded along under the weight of a grown man. It's absurd. It's laughable. It's as startlingly ridiculous as seeing stressed out people scramble and fight to buy and sell invisible symbols of their wealth on Wall Street while the homeless grasp for mere coins on the steps outside. It's absurd. The people, they're shouting, "Save us, Jesus, save us." They are quoting scripture about the Messiah, the Savior, the Lord that would send to rescue them, to defeat their oppressors. And here he comes, plodding along slowly, awkwardly, quietly, riding on a donkey's colt. It is a masterclass in political satire. Jesus knows full well that his actions will be received as a threat to the authority of the Roman Empire. But he also knows that that authority is unjust. It is unjust. He knows the methods used by one group to take and hold power over another. They're always displays of the worldly power of evil. But they're not the way that God intends for creation to be. And instead of beating them at their own game, their own unjust game, he refuses to play by their rules at all. He refuses to join their game. And as he has always done, he invites the people to follow a different way. My good friend, Pastor Kate Murphy, over at the Grove here in Charlotte, she thinks that Palm Sunday was misnamed in the tradition of the church. She thinks it should be called Donkey Sunday. And I am inclined to agree with her. The palms, they're nothing, really. They just happen to be the kind of tree branches available to the people who gathered. The crowds greeting the Roman governor at the West Gate, they would have been waving palms too. They would have been waving them under threat of punishment if they didn't. But they would have been waving palms too. But do you know what would never be found in that procession of worldly power and military might? A donkey. Jesus chooses a donkey to carry him. Not a war horse, not a chariot, or cart even. If someone witnessing these events had only so far heard rumors about Jesus, This would certainly get their attention. Some would be intrigued and inspired, maybe, by the courage. Others, perhaps, disappointed. Disappointed that their hoped-for Savior could only seem to find a donkey to carry him to victory. There would be people asking the same question that we have today, the question from our series for Palm Sunday: what's so special about Jesus? What makes him different than all the others who claim to know the way to enter the kingdom of God? Why should we follow this one? How do we follow this one? In her words about Donkey Sunday, Reverend Murphy says, Jesus comes into Jerusalem to pick a fight. To pick a fight with all the forces that oppose the goodness of God. He shows up for a fight, and he enters the city in the fullness of his power. But it is not the power of violence, the power to kill. It's the power of love, willing to suffer unto death. You see, if you provoke evil, you better be ready to fight. And Jesus is. But we have to understand his way, his tactic, or if we don't, the enemy of our souls will have us out here fighting for evil instead of fighting against it, and all the while we will believe we are doing the Lord's work. Jesus comes to overturn the powers, the principalities that kill, that destroy, that lie, that steal life. He comes to overturn those powers. But he doesn't come with a sword, church. He doesn't ask people to become soldiers. There's no such thing as the Lord's army, church. But he calls us to be more than conquerors. That doesn't mean Uber soldiers. It means to be more than a conqueror. Because there is something more than conquering and destroying. There is. And those who follow Jesus are it. Those who follow Jesus are more than conquerors. They are servants. They are servants. Which is why Jesus rides a donkey. Not a war horse. He isn't a conquering king like we expect. He's a servant king, which is why he rides a donkey that is humble but strong, a donkey that bears burdens, capable of carrying heavy loads many times its own weight, capable of moving through rough terrain, making a new way where there wasn't one before, able to break new ground, to overturn hardened earth until it becomes fallow and ready to grow new life. That's what donkeys do. That's the choice, the way that Jesus makes. And if Jesus is going to be our Lord and our Savior and not just our mascot, church, then we better understand that Jesus comes to disrupt and overturn the power of sin and violence and death. He does. He comes to destroy them, to fight, as only he can. And his followers are called to do the same. But church, we have to understand that the weapons of our Lord are nothing like the weapons of this world. Nothing. They're nothing like the ways of the empire. Those who live by the sword die by the sword. And the kingdom of God doesn't come through violence. It doesn't. It won't. It never will. the kingdom of God comes only through the weapon of God that is a way. Not an instrument, it is a way. It is the way of the donkey. The way of the donkey, a love that serves and heals and saves. If we don't understand the donkey, we don't understand Jesus. If we don't have eyes to see the glory and the beauty of the Savior of the world entering Jerusalem riding a donkey, then we don't see God's kingdom coming. If we can't see and believe in the power of the donkey, then we can't see and believe in the power of the cross. Beloveds, Jesus calls us to follow him. His way is different than the ways of the world, and if it doesn't feel different, we would do well to look again at just who or what we believe will save us. His way is risky, because he will bring us face to face with injustice and with the power of evil. His way will make us vulnerable. It will soften us. It will make us fools. Fools who believe that undaunted, courageous, sacrificial love for others can actually change the world. Even when evil looms large around us, I'd say especially when evil looms large around us, that's when the way of love is the most powerful. That's when the world is changed, church. That's when we can see most clearly who is our hope and our salvation. That's when we remember that the way of Jesus is the way of the donkey, slow and steady, humble and trusting. A sturdy, gentle, subversive strength that reshapes the very ground beneath our feet, making a way where there seems to be no way at all. My friends, trust the way. Trust the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is faithful and trustworthy. He may constantly surprise us, but he will not fail. All honor, glory, power be to God. Amen. Church, let us pray. Loving God, we sing with the people, blessed is the King, the one who comes in the name of the Lord. As we stand at the gates of the city, this entrance into Holy Week, Lord, grant us the grace to recognize the King that we proclaim. Give us courage to be part of your kingdom, even when it goes against our ways and the ways of the world. Even when it leads us where we're afraid to go. Empower us, set us free from the things that tempt us, the power, the wealth, the status. Give us courage to live lives of thanksgiving and praise. Give us the courage to walk with you along the way. As you walked alongside those who suffer, those who are left out, discarded. Lord, teach us to walk there. So that restoration can be found, people can be restored to community and find healing. Lord, teach us to walk where you walked with the sick, in need of healing, those who are broken in body, mind, or spirit. Lord, guide our eyes to see all people as whole, to see ourselves as healers instead of dividers. Lord, teach us to walk with you. Teach us to embody your teaching that the first shall be last and the last shall be first. Lord, be our vision so that your kingdom can be realized around us and within us, so that all will know that they are beloved children of the Holy. Lord, we know that violence and suffering, hatred, harm, pain, those are things that are real and powerful in our world. So, Lord, teach us the power of the cross, the power of sacrifice, the power of forgiveness, the power of hope and trust and peace. Make it real in our own lives, in our homes, in our church, in our communities, Lord, in your world. Give us the courage to follow to the cross, to the tomb, and then into new life. Lord, there are many that we carry on our hearts this morning. Those whom we love who are in need of your presence, your care, your comfort. And so we lift them to you right now. We speak their names in our hearts or aloud among our church family, Lord. We offer their names to you. Lord, the names are many. The needs are immense. But we trust that you are the one who can bring what is needed, who can heal what hurts, who can bring life out of death. Help us to trust you in all of these things and with all of these people. Hear us now, Lord, as we, your people, pray the prayer Jesus gave us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As Megan just so wonderfully described to us, Pilate led with power, wealth, and force. But Jesus, our role model, led on a donkey, and he teaches us to lead with humility, service, and spirit. He teaches us to give of our time, talent, or treasure, not to build up a powerful institution, but to be used in the service of God. To be used for the people Jesus came to save. These gifts enable all of us to carry out Christ's mission of love, service, and truth in the world. You can give to God through our church website or in the offering plates at the front and the back of the church as you leave worship today. In our giving, may God set us free. Now let's rise and lift our voices and sing, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less," hymn 353.
Beloveds, go from this place into Holy Week to hear and tell the story of God's great love for you, for the whole world. And go knowing that Christ leads you on. Christ will not fail, ever. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, who does not fail, may the love of God, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you this day and always. Let's sing our Amen.